that's very, very informative also. And I have a follow-up question to that. So when you're talking about delivering an experience and connecting everything in your car and your life, you're talking about basically knowing in and out what you as a customer want, which means tracking each and every bit of your life, which already happens through multiple outlets like on your phone, whether it's Google or Facebook. Stop short of listening in on your conversations, which they are actually allowed to do if they want. But when you're talking about taking this and putting it in the third living space, which is your car, there is another massive amount of data that is going to be generated and it's going to be tracked and analyzed, and services are going to be pushed to you, etc., etc. So obviously, the first question that comes to my mind is, how secure is this going to be? Who is going to have access to my data? Who is going to own this data? Because whoever owns this data at the end of the day is going to have the most hold over me as a customer or as a person. So what do you think about that?
Okay, a little bit of background. This has been for over 100 years, because we started in 1886 in the business of automotive technology. So we have been a part of the journey of the life. We have seen through diesel engines coming into life. We have seen through the common red direct injection being introduced, market gas red direct injection. So we have always been known as an automotive company. Right? So by default, it was known as an automotive company. But 2 years ago, we had a small change. We decided to rename our main division as the mobility business. So, because mobility is the largest shell which covers the automotive space. So, if you look at what has changed, then it was we were always a product centric, asset driven industry. But from there, we've been seeing that even the trends in the mobility segment have changed a lot. If you look at it, starting with something like autonomous vehicles, or you're going towards electric mobility, you're talking about shared mobility, you're talking about flexible ownership models, maybe you talk about fractional ownership, and then you have, so these are a number of things that are going to happen. So it basically means that it's just a matter of time when, but the industry is not going to be the same as yesterday. Maybe if you, and we can't always follow the old trend that yes, it'll first happen in Europe and US. And US will, India will follow data. Because that's the case with emission norms, because when we spoke about balance sheet, 1, 2, 3, 4, we were 8 years behind Europe. But that's not going to be the case now, because it's possible. See, if you just look at markets like India, today not even 5% of Indians own a car. Right? In spite of which, the kind of having experiences in Pune, but in a place in Bangalore, the average speed is less than 8 kilometers an hour. Okay. So what does that indicate? So you cannot continue the same model, because the buying power of people is increasing, the middle class is getting more and more influential, but then the next generation, the younger generation is no longer looking at having a spanky, stylish car, because their aspirations are quite different. So given that people are going towards shared mobility or multimodal mobility, this is the step forward. So now what happens in a scenario like this? You have a range of services being offered. There are also a number of other services which I'm not going to focus on, which are closely related to mobility. But if you're talking about the kind of services which would be really new and not thought of, would include something like as basic as connectivity. Because, like, for example, the model of my company has changed from a traditional diesel gas approach to saying that we work on 3 S's. One is sensors, software, and services. So this is going to be the direction forward. So, sensors, and I know if many of you know, most of the MEMS sensors were originally developed by Bosch. I'm not here, I'm not marketing company, sorry. Okay. So, MEMS were ones that, you know, all your accelerometers, gyroscopes, all of them, which are at a miniature edge level, which go into phones today, were developed like that. But then, we knew that sensors is one strong point we have. We have very, very established software, but the next thing to monetize would come in from services. So now, at a very basic level, I would say services would include some kind of connectivity services, would include things related to security, then finally identity management, lifecycle management, so that and monetization. So this could be the broad spectrum of services which is going to be the mainstay. And I think software as a service in some way or other gets broadly linked with one of these.
So I think Bosch is basically looking at software as a service for automobiles in a very big way in the future, and we can expect software as a service to come about in the near future.
That's right. It's not the market research which is available at McKinsey, Deloitte, all of them, make a very conservative figure of 500 billion as the size of the
500 billion.
And upwards of that. The very conservative figure is the size of the opportunity in the services space. So I think that's going to be moving forward because like I said, it's going to multimodal transport, all of them are going to be a part of it. Right? So services is a place where we are very serious about. And that's going to be the key thing for us to move forward.
All right, since we're on the topic of software and as a service for automobiles, I'd like to get Trevor's views on that. How are you guys looking at? I'm going to ask you, but just what are your views on?
I just want to connect to what was said before that sensors play a big role, but I want to add not only software as a service, also what I heard before is that out of the sensors we get a lot of data. The question is if we have to connect it or if we compute it directly in the car. That's another question, but I expect, yes, that the business change, the ownership of car change, especially when you look maybe in India, you have to change it to guarantee mobility. In Europe, maybe it really changed from mine, because in Germany it's really like that you own the car and it starts to change. But on the back, yes, I think also the value changes because we see we are here, but directly if you look behind the car, it is the software, it is mainly also the data that we take out of these sensors that we use to support these machine learning algorithms, deep learning. And to generate the new functionality for autonomous driving, for ADAS, for safety functionalities that we support with them. And with that, we can also think about software as a service, because we can update and we can add new functionality without changing the mechanical model or the electronic of the car itself. So software as a service will come here.
One point I just missed, the biggest challenge would be who owns this data? Because the reason is a company like ours provides most of the microcontrollers for almost most of the controllers for most of the cars. But the ownership itself, every OEM would like to have, because the OEM itself would like to grow.
So the source of the data, that's what it is. Yeah. Source of data generation.
That's right. But then, just like how we have monopolistic and restrictive trade practices kind of things in different parts of the world, at least in Europe, you already have kind of regulation which doesn't allow this kind of right to ownership, except something which is very personal data or something that's a different issue. So the law is still not very well defined in different parts of the world, but it has to be a level playing field for not incumbents, otherwise it becomes the duopoly is the smaller one and it goes on, so it can't work like that. So I think it's an opportunity for a lot of stakeholders to jump into and do it.
Just on that, my personal take on this is, as of today, most of this data is individual OEMs. So when, I'm sure someone who is working on automotive gears, you take a particular service or a particular module to say a big OEM, is quoting a say a BMW or now Audi, they would definitely throw you back some data and say, hey, go improve on this. And then the service provider will go into a dizzy, go into a huddle, find out what to do right about it. And this, at some point, it would break. Because if it is autonomous driving, it is not just about a business initiative, it's also a lot more of social impact that you bring into a society. So if we are all able on business hats, look at it, it's a lot more productivity increase just by bringing in, it's several trillions of productivity increase if I cut the transport time. There's a huge amount of, uplift that you get from, you know, human lives that are saved today because of the driver intelligence that would go away, right? So a lot of these would be a lot more social impact. So given that, and also encourage research around, I think in my view, the data set should be open. Today, it's all closed. It's coming up very slowly, you know, academics, for example, if you look at today, you have data sets like, Oxford is putting it out, Google is putting it out, many of the, including CMU, are putting out some of their data sets. They're a little bit more academic. What's important is there should be a consortium which should put out this data set. So that you also get around all these geospatial grid. If you look at even in India, not just various geospatial in India, it's hugely restricted. Maybe because we look at it as, hey, we would break safety norms if I carry my camera and take some pictures around it. But I think this should be disassociated from our standard mapping or data collections, the regular data collections. But this should be more for, okay, how can I improve research or how can I improve modules for any of these driverless or autonomous driving or safety considerations which would have a larger social impact. So if, unless we look at it that way, it would become really walled gardens, and I don't think we would proceed collectively as a society or as a industry also. That's my personal opinion. There would be many folks who would actually generate revenues out of collecting this data, but I agree as a larger cause, it should be best that we should
implement. Right. I was just going to ask Rajatan Sriram as from the OEM side, what is your take on what Kamal just said about you guys generating the data from your sensors and from your vehicles? Are you going to look to capitalize on that in terms of pushing services or working with other companies, whether it's intelligent systems or lifestyle and infotainment systems, pushing services to the customers? Or are you going to have the data open for everybody to develop on, maybe develop things like an app platform like the Android App Store or the iOS Store? What is the plan from the OEM side about the data generation?
So I think first we need to look at, we need to have a balanced view. If we open up the data, there is a potential of infringement of privacy and data loss, data theft, and whatnot. So that's one aspect. Second, we need to also bifurcate the data. So if it is an operational data, the data which the vehicle generates, right? Is that the customer data? Is that the owner data? Or is it something which will help the OEM better the equipment and solve some safety issues or provide more service? So that would be another aspect. The customer data or the person who is using the car, his own data is the profiling of the customer, the way he or she drives around, uses the car. That has to be absolutely the customer data, the personal data. It cannot be shared unless the customer or the person agrees. Now, yes, in essence, in spirit, the data should be open and so that we can have more innovation around it, analytical models develop, intelligent systems, deep learning and whatnot, build on it. But we just have to balance it out with what can go wrong from that perspective. OEMs as such, everybody is coming up with their own data strategy, and they are bifurcating the data in different areas, in different buckets. For instance, operational data, machine data, customer data, and even going beyond that. So, based on each of those strategies, the regulations for the countries, we'll have to come up with a plan. In India, I think, hopefully, we will have some regulation around it. What I've heard is there are some regulations the government has already built up in area of where the data could be hosted and of what kind. So we are still there, but we are not mature enough to kind of deal with the issues of data privacy, data theft, infringement yet.
Rajan,
but I think the cyber security might also be an answer.
Yeah, so, I mean, that's what I meant when I said security of data. It's a big one.
The liabilities, usually it's with the OEM. The OEM has to be the most careful.
Absolutely, yeah.
I think it's the reason that some part of data has to remain basic.
Absolutely, yeah. If I'm driving a car and I'm driving, say, a Mahindra car, and Mahindra has data about my driving habits or something, they get hacked and I start getting spammed. I'm going to take whatever the protection I can about it. And getting spammed is just like the smallest inconvenience that would happen. There can be so much more of a security threat that might happen. And not just from a personal point of view, but also if you look at like large commercial fleets where there's sensitive business information that is actually very easily, withdrawable from the data. So yeah, just to close with us,
I think everybody has said what it is. And it is because what typically happens, especially in the commercial arena, what we see that different OEMs are part of data. Confidentiality and all is something which people want to maintain and they don't want to share. And this kind of challenges we do face, and I'm sure data has to rest with what Shinab spoke about. And with the OEM and used rightly. So it should not be something which can be an open thing.
Alright. So basically, having vault pockets of data, some of it for public good, some of it has to be private and secure. I think that's the consensus. So we have time for one last question, and this is something that I've obviously dabbled in from a personal point of view, because our analytics work on driver profiling and driving analytics, and that is something that is used very extensively in the US and Europe to provide driver profile based insurance or usage based insurance. So a lot of you might know that till around 10 years back or 8 years back in the States, they would have insurance based on how much you drive your vehicle, because people who drive more are putting their vehicles more at risk. The latest trend that's happened is where they actually track how you drive your vehicle in the first month of, say, applying for insurance. So they actually put a device in your car and they track you. They track your driving habits and they make a driver profile of yours. And if you're a rash driver, then your insurance premiums go up, actually, which is a very logical way to go about it. But we haven't seen this in India at all. Automotive insurance in India is still pretty age-old and hasn't really been changed in a couple of decades. And when you talk about insurance, I think commercial vehicles actually drive the insurance sector first, and then personal vehicles catch up. So my question to both Rajat and Shriram is basically, what is the scenario in terms of automotive insurance looking like in India? When are we likely to see a usage-based insurance, if at all?
That's a very difficult prediction at the moment. I think we've got a very, very long way to go on insurance. Because insurance, if you typically see today, commercial vehicles, specific, it's only the period while it is financed and the financier insists the insurance is a comprehensive insurance. The moment the vehicle is out of finance and it becomes a customer vehicle, it gets into a third party insurance. So even that's first kind of an insight on this. He doesn't want to spend that money. He says that it's better get it repaired locally in case an accident happens. And a third party is something which is kind of regulatory, you can't go without it, so you can have insurance done. Now, so commercial vehicle, I think it's a very, very long way to go, but definitely from the insurance company perspectives, what we have seen is they are going, tying up with the OEMs, trying and understanding what are the part life and the part behaviors and the part cost, and what it would mean in terms of safety and all. So they have started understanding this on an OEM basis. And based on that, trying and defining what would be the kind of premiums which they could charge to the customer. But I think a policy is required in the country first. because neither driver tracking is happening nor you look at, you know, how they drive. Now, typically, if you see the insurance surveys also show that if you put your headlights on during the day, the rate of accident goes down drastically. You know, it's a survey that shows that. And if you go to US and Europe, there are countries where certain states and all do say put on your headlights while you're driving on the highways. Now here we do have day running lights which are more of fancy, but the fact remains that it is definitely helping in terms of reducing the accidents. So these kind of things, I think those awareness have to build first, understand, and then possibly the right tracking and understanding what it is. And the first step, at least what we are trying to take as a part of the telematics, what we are offering to the customers, is that how he gets into a driver rating based on certain parameters. And if that gets evolved in a nice manner, that could really help you know, taking the whole thing forward. But I personally feel it's a very, very long way to go.
So, last couple of years, some insurance companies in India have tried this. This Bajaj Alliance, they did come up with Drive Smart program, and they have a mobility device which does something like this. The other insurance companies, to the best of my knowledge, have done a small POC pilots. They did not find enough takers, and in short run, and so they didn't move ahead. However, I was very good experience. I was riding a car from Delhi to Chandigarh, and that car was operated by a fleet owner. So driver was driving it. The business model of that driver was he was getting paid based on, you know, so on a certain amount, and from his operator, and the amount would be, you know, whatever car gives as an average, above it, okay. So it's an incentive list. It's getting a flat, and anything above the average mileage the car gives, it's
it. So it's an incentive list to drive better.
Right, so if you look at, it might be insurance company, it might not be, but it could be a new business model coming all together, where the fleet operators might start incentivizing using such devices and coming up with a new model altogether. So we don't know. It might just evolve. Maybe that could be one data point why Jio is interested. There are companies who are looking at telcos looking at it. So there is a good potential. It's just that we have not really looked at all other areas where it could be used apart from the traditional insurance in this case. It's not going to happen in short run. That's what Thomas said.
And I just like to add, he just said, rather the commercial vehicles, especially the truck, the business model is only the fuel. The driver's salary is calculated in a manner that what fuel he saves. And the biggest threat for OEMs like us is that there is a fuel theft which happens, and there is a complete kind of argument which is taking place. And that's where we see that this connected trucks and the telematics is going to really help, because that's going to show the factual data of the performance of the vehicle. So this business model does prevail, and the whole fight in the industry is all about the fuel and nothing else.
Just to add a point to that, this actually came as a surprise to us even when we started working with logistics companies and transporters. And what we found out is that all the company owners and the directors, the managers, they all know that drivers need fuel and they accept it as a part of their business. So what they basically say is that you get $1,000 for fuel to reach from point A to point B. Now, if you do it in $750 of fuel, you can keep the $250. I don't care about it. That's the model. It's an open sort of like cheating model. And that's the incentive given to the driver. Okay. Their salaries are like maybe 10-15 grand a month, and they make like 5-6 grand on top through this open fuel fridge model. Just something that really surprised us when we started working with these guys, and we were like astounded. Asked them why do you let them do that? Why don't you stop it? We can tell you very easily what the mileage should be or what you're getting. They were like, bus, ye hota nahi hai, aise nahi chalega. So yeah. So now another aspect of that would be the reason I generated this was maybe the driver won't know how what would save the fuel as well. So that would be, so if the OBD tells the smartphone the driver is carrying that is braking or is speeding and that is causing the fuel utilization more than what it should be, which in turn will impact his pockets, behavior would change. It's incentivizing the behavioral change, which would be a different perspective that we can get out.
Right, that's funny you said that. That's exactly what we are doing actually with companies, where we're helping them train the drivers better. One aspect of it where we actually show them that this driver is bad and he does a lot of rash breaks, takes a lot of sharp turns, he swerves at high speed, and that is actually affecting his mileage and the vehicle's performance. So it's like what you said is absolutely 100% true, that it is something that we're trying to bring about a slow change. But yeah, I think like everyone put it, all of that translating to a different business model, whether it's for owners or for insurance companies, is probably half a decade away in this country, if not more. Right, so that was the last point that we had to discuss, and I'd like to thank everyone for joining us, thank the panelists especially, very insightful and deeply knowledgeable answers. Thanks a lot.
Well, I'd like to thank all the panelists and Shivalik, of course. Shivalik, before I let the panelists get off stage, I'm going to request you to present them with a token of appreciation from our audience.
Thank you.